Hello everyone, we are now ready to start. Thank you and welcome to today's live webinar, How to Assess Drug Candidates on Tinnitus Preclinical Models for a Successful Transition to Clinic. My name is Diane. I am the Marketing Manager at Neuroservices Alliance and I will be moderating today's webinar. This event is the fourth of a series of live webinars. Each of them features one or several of the Alliance members' neuroscientist experts and showcase their work to show you how Neuroservices Alliance can be your efficient CNS drug discovery partner. We know that your time is valuable, which is why our online events all follow today's format, 20-minute presentation followed by 10-minute questions and answer. If you have any question at any time, please don't hesitate to submit them in the question box that is located at the bottom of the GoToWebinar panel. Your questions will be answered right after the presentation. This session is recorded and you will receive the recording after the live session. However, I strongly encourage that you stay until the end as it is the occasion to have our speaker answer your questions live. Before we start, I would like to introduce Neuroservices Alliance. For those who don't know us, we are a consortium of CNS contract research organizations. Our team is specialized in in vitro and in vivo electrophysiological and behavioral studies. Our goal is to deliver endpoints, facilitating decision-making to our clients for their CNS drug discovery programs. We value direct and efficient interactions with our clients, and we rely on a team of more than 50 PhD scientists. As a speaker, we have Sylvie Plucher with us today. Sylvie is the Chief Scientist Officer of SilkCare. Hello, Sylvie. Welcome, and I will let you take the lead from here.
Thank you, Dan. First, I would like to thank the organizer who gave me the opportunity to present tinnitus preclinical models to evaluate therapeutic solutions for people suffering from hearing disorders and particularly tinnitus. Now let's enter into the details of our tinnitus model, starting with an introduction on the importance of hearing in our life and the role of SilkCare in the fight against hearing disorders. Then I describe what tinnitus is and where science stands with regards to the underlying mechanism and option for treatments. Finally, I will present data on our preclinical models aiming to assess the efficacy of your drug candidates in treating or preventing the onset of tinnitus. 15% of the world's population experience hearing deficiencies, and this number is increasing for one out of three over 65 years old and one out of four over 45 years old. It's disabling. Why is this happening? Aging populations, noisy lifestyle, infections, and the more than 200 ototoxic drugs on the market, like cisplatin cancer treatments, which irreversibly damage hearing. SilkCare is a world leading CRO with unique expertise in hearing disorders. Our mission is to support pharma, biotechs, academics in the development of new therapies to treat hearing loss, tinnitus, and otitis. SilkCare operates worldwide from its facilities in France and in Lexington, Massachusetts, where we partner with CBCET. We chose them because in the same way that we are recognized as world experts in everything that deals with your ears, they are experts in translational research and are linked to MIT. For each program you have, we help you select the best preclinical pathway and models to assess your candidates on hearing loss, age-related, drug or noise-induced, tinnitus or otitis. SilkCare services include non-GLP and GLP studies, PK and tox studies to bring you to NID submission. We are used to working on small molecule antibodies, but also gene therapies and medical devices such as cochlear implants and drug delivery systems. Tinnitus can be perceived as an intermittent or continuous sound, which can be constant or fluctuating in intensity and pitch through the day. Around 10% of the population suffers from tinnitus and is often associated with hearing loss. It can greatly reduce quality of life, causing anxiety, depression, and even suicide in the most severe case. It can happen after physical or acoustic trauma or following the intake of chemical compounds. Today, there is no pharmacological treatment on the market to treat tinnitus. Current options to help patients are off-label drugs such as analgesics, neuromodulators, or nutraceuticals. There are also masking therapies, which consist in delivering a sound to the patient, or cognitive therapies, which help patients to live with their tinnitus. COVID-19 brings to us a host of health concerns. Most of these symptoms are respiratory. However, there are some concerns that the coronavirus may cause some neurological symptoms as tinnitus. While is it too early to know whether a potential vaccine will have any risk of ototoxicity, some currently investigated treatments do pose a potential risk to the auditory system. The quinine family of drugs, historically used for prophylactic prevention and treatment of malaria, have some history of ototoxicity. The anatomy of the ear is very complex. The ear is composed of three parts, the outer ear and the middle ear, separated by the eardrum, ensures the transfer of sound waves to the inner ear. The inner ear is composed of two distinct sensory organs, the vestibule organ responsible for balance, and the cochlea organ responsible for hearing. The cochlea contains air cells, which transform a stimulus into a nervous message, which will then be sent to the brain. Several targets are described at different levels of the auditory pathway, which are potential targets for drug development in tinnitus. For example, this figure comes from the analysis of 275 compounds that elicit tinnitus as a side effect, and their targets were reported in database. They use a quantitative score to identify emergent significant targets that were more common. As of today, the state of the art shows targets such as NMDA receptor, cannabinoid receptor, and inflammatory cytokine are directly involved in tinnitus. This result might pave the way towards the design of a novel pharmacotherapies. Today, tinnitus diagnosis rely on self-report for the subject. Therefore, the use of animal models remains challenging, as we have to mimic patient self-reporting with behavioral assessments that need to be cross-confirmed with more objective measures like electrophysiology and MRI. Electrophysiology has good potential for becoming the next translational marker for tinnitus. Indeed, in humans, it is rarely possible to measure spontaneous electrical brain activity except at a high level in the brain, the cerebral cortex. In tinnitus, large number of brain cells produce oscillations or brain waves that can be detected using electroencephalography or EEG. In the same way, in animals, an increase of spontaneous neuronal activity in the primary auditory cortex can be measured using microelectrodes. Imaging techniques are also very promising. PET or positron emission tomography imaging and fMRI or functional magnetic resonance imaging have shown interesting results in humans. While in animals studies, MRI imaging techniques enhanced by manganese or MEMRI have shown some alterations of auditory brain areas in tinnitus models. However, if electrophysiology and imaging techniques allow the detection of the increase of neural activity in some brain areas, more direct correlation need to be further established with tinnitus symptoms. As a consequence, Silcare implements in its model objective measures like electrophysiology or MMRI, coupled with behavioral assessment using a modified prepuce inhibition of the acoustic startle reflex, or GPIS. Now, concerning Silcare preclinical tinnitus model, we propose two RATS models. One is included by salicylate and leads to transient tinnitus, like in humans, when taking high dose of aspirin. The second one is induced by noise and leads to chronic tinnitus. We combine functional measure of auditory function with brain activity assessment by behavioral tests, cerebral imaging, and electrophysiology to assess the level of tinnitus in animals. Our first readout used to detect tinnitus in our RATS model is the GPS test. It's based on the ability of the acoustic startle reflex induced by a strong noise or startle pulse to be reduced by a preceding signal. The signal could be a prepulse sound called PPI or a short period of silence called gap. The PPI allows to assess auditory functions during GPS test conditions. This test is required to perform the gap detection analysis. The gap detection allows to assess the presence of tinnitus based on the startle reflex response. As you can see in B, the gap is introduced in the background sound, consisting of a broadband noise or noise at different frequencies, leading to a decrease of the startle response. It is well described that in the presence of tinnitus, this gap is filled by the tinnitus, as you can see in D. So the animal does not hear the gap and is not warned of the sound arrival, leading to a controlled startle response. The results are expressed as delta or percentage of inhibition equal to the difference of startle reflex amplitude divided by the startle reflex amplitude obtained in standard conditions. Our second readout is the MEMRI, or manganese enhanced magnetic resonance imaging. This is a relatively new imaging method that is not dependent upon blood flow. Manganese enters in neurons via calcium channels and accumulates in the activated brain areas, like the inferior colliculus and cochlear nucleus in case of tinnitus. The signal-noise ratio is determined using imaging software, and a new cartography, 100T2, used represents the regions with high manganese relaxation. Our third readout corresponds to auditory cortex unicellular electrophysiology. Tinnitus induces an increase of spontaneous activity and invokes responses in the auditory cortex. Using a microelectrode on the primary auditory cortex, we can record the spontaneous neuronal activity in vivo. We can observe a significant increase in the number of spontaneous spikes 30 days after acoustic trauma compared to control. These results are correlated with a behavioral GPS test. We have two different protocols for the salicylate-induced tinnitus model. We select the most appropriate based on the mechanism of action of your compound and on the readouts you want to have. The first protocol will allow you to assess both tinnitus and hyperacusis in 5-day in vivo experiments. In this study, we will be able to administer your compound over several days if needed. At baseline, we excluded animals without good hearing using ABR threshold. And at D1, we measured GPS, which is a reference readout for tinnitus, before salicylate administration by IP route, and then again 2 hours later. We do a second GPS test at D4 to estimate the number of animals with tinnitus under chronic treatment. We would recommend the second protocol if you want to include an MRI as a second readout to correlate with the behavioral measures. In this one, we do a single administration of your compound. We do the same baseline measurements than in protocol one. And at day two, we do the first salicylate administration and the second GPS measure. The two last days are used for MEMRI measure. Manganese is administered at day three by transtympanic route, 6 hours before a salicylate administration. This study can also be stopped at day two and allow you to screen compounds in a very short term. Conditioned food reward is a behavioral test consisting to train the animals in associating a sight to a noise or to a silence or a white noise. In this test, the animals perform a nose poke on the corresponding side and receive a food reward for a correct answer. During quiet intervals, animals exhibiting tinnitus perform a nose poke on the wrong side. Silker has conducted a big research program to compare three techniques to detect tinnitus in salicylate rat models, the CFR, the GPS test I have presented you just before, and the MEMRI. After 3 months of training for the CFR test, the animals were subjected to GPS and CFR baseline, followed by tinnitus evaluations 2 hours post-salicylate injection. And after a single injection of salicylate, all animals simultaneously presented a decrease in the proportion of correct response in the CFR test and in the percentage of gap inhibition. We show here an example of result we obtain on these three techniques after salicylate treatment. The CFR results show a significant decrease of proportion of correct answer for quiet trials. The gap results demonstrate that the salicylate group has tinnitus. We observe a decrease of inhibition of gap test at BBN in salicylate group compared to the vehicle group. And the MEMRI results obtained at the end of the study show that we have an increase of neuronal activity in the primary auditory cortex at the level of the inferior colliculus and the cochlear nucleus. The H graphs represent the potential results that can be obtained with an effective treatment on the appearance of tinnitus on gap and MEMRI results. In summary, after a single injection of salicylate, all animals simultaneously presented a decrease in the percentage of gap inhibition, a decrease in the proportion of correct response in the CFR test, and similarly, the MEMRI test established an increase of neuronal activity in the inferior colliculus and in the cochlear nucleus. All the results observed in both behavioral tests and in the MEMRI imaging analysis supported the presence of tinnitus after a salicylate injection in all animals. This preliminary data establish a more robust tinnitus model to accelerate the development of new therapies. Just to let you know the study came out for the noise model, the study lasts 10 weeks, as tinnitus takes 4 weeks to develop after acoustic trauma and becomes chronic from week 7. The gap detection paradigm was used for assessing behavioral evidence of tinnitus in rats, mal Langevin's rats, after an acoustic trauma. The gap detection or sham or noise exposed rats was assessed before exposure at 4, 6, and 8 weeks after noise exposure. Two indications can be targeted: prevention of tinnitus onset and treatment of chronic tinnitus. Note at week 1, we can verify that we have a TTS using ABR threshold, then hearing is recovered. In this slide, we show here an example of results we obtained on this noise-induced tinnitus model. First, at the top, we can see that PPI inhibition reflect auditory capacity is higher than 50% for all animals at all frequency, demonstrating that animals entering the gap test have good hearing. In figure B, are presented individual tinnitus results. In figure B is presented the mean of gap detection minus PPI inhibition. And we can see that there is a decrease of this value at week 8 at 12 kilohertz. A larger variability was observed in the BQ group, which should be attributed to hearing impairment. And for this reason, we decide to present the results with a subtraction of PPI results. The objective of preclinical research is to bring new therapies to clinic. Today, there are two promising compounds in phase two clinical trials. The AM101, and this week, the gasicladine, two NMDA antagonists, shown positive and encouraging results. The gasicladine shown an improvement of tinnitus for 43% of treated patients. However, the clinical development is still a challenge, and several compounds failed at a late stage, and their development was subsequently discontinued. It is mainly due to the heterogeneity of tinnitus by itself as multiple causal risk factor. Fortunately, we know which areas we need to focus on. For preclinical trials, we need to work on global acceptance and use of the same models and readouts. And for clinical trials, there also needs to be a harmonization of study designs. TREE and TNET are currently working on this, and I encourage you to visit their website. In conclusion, there is a both strong medical need for tinnitus treatment and strong scientific data supporting the rationale for a lot of targets. Silker's tinnitus validated model provides a reliable and robust tool to assess the efficacy of therapeutics on tinnitus using complementary readouts. If you want to know more about tinnitus targets and new auditory therapies to prevent or cure auditory disorders, please do not hesitate to contact us. I also invited you to read our recently published Springer book. Thank you for your attention. Diane, do you have any questions?
Yes, so thank you very much, Sylvie. So before asking a live question, we have some questions that were asked by some registrants. First one is, which medications can be used safely by ENT specialists in both tinnitus and hyperacusia?
So today there is no pharmacological treatment on the market to treat tinnitus. Current options to help patients are off-label drugs such as analgesic neuromodulators or nutraceuticals like ginkgo biloba extract. There are also masking therapies, which consist to deliver a sound, or cognitive therapies, which help patients to live with their tinnitus. All medications carry a benefit-risk ratio to be evaluated for each patient. And today, no drugs has demonstrated a significant benefit for tinnitus. Medication may be used mostly to address some of the more dramatic consequences of tinnitus, such as depression. The most recent clinical practice guidelines published in 2019 by European group is giving a WAKE recommendation against pharmacological treatments for tinnitus, as they found no evidence for the effectiveness of drug treatments specifically for tinnitus, but evidence for potentially significant side effects. Their recommendation is based on systematic reviews and randomized trials.
Thank you, Sylvie. Next one, best models for clinical trials for tinnitus. Is an umbrella design desirable?
In an umbrella trial, more than one targeted therapy is tested for one or more subtypes of a single disease. I think this would be relevant for tinnitus, as definitively there are a vast diversity of patients within the tinnitus population. However, genetics of tinnitus is still in its infancy. Despite some recent data alluding to genetic factors in tinnitus, a strong association with any specific genetic locus has not yet been shown up to my knowledge. A careful selection of an homogeneous patient population would be strongly recommended for a first proof of concept study.
Okay, thank you. Now, how do your animal models distinguish tinnitus from hearing loss?
We use a specific test to detect tinnitus, a gap test. We demonstrated in a large research program that it was comparable to CFR, another behavioral model, which is a reference gold standard test to detect tinnitus in preclinical models. Our gap test allowed to test the efficacy of compounds on tinnitus quite rapidly with the salicylate model. And before any animal randomization, we test hearing. And also, we measure hearing with ABR and with a PPI, which is very important for the GPS test.
Okay. Next question is, what is a positive control used in your model?
In fact, there is no reference compound, as you know, so far for tinnitus, as there are no drugs currently approved on the market. But we test esketamine in our model, but it's confidential data. We test it for a client. I can't show you.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Sylvie. So now, if you can see in the questions panel, there are a couple more questions that have been asked. Do you want to look at them directly, or I can read them for you as you want?
I can't see any question.
Can you see them?
No.
In the little questions tab? Well, I can read them in the order if you want.
Example in addition to systemic? That's the question?
Oh, no, the questions in the GoToWebinar control panel that were just asked live by attendees.
If you want, you can read it because I can't see.
I will, so just so that everyone know, I will read them in the order. And if we don't have time to answer every question, we will answer you by email. So one of the question is, what are the reasons for NMDA drugs failure in the clinic?
An NMDA antagonist, yes, it's a very promising therapeutic strategy for tinnitus. And so there is two compounds in clinic with this indication. In fact, the NMDA, the efficacy of NMDA antagonist for the first time was demonstrated in 2003 by UL's team. And their conclusion was that the study provide evidence for a new pharmacological target effect in the salicylate model. In addition to reducing outer cell electromotility, salicylate may act on cochlear fast synaptic transmission via the activation of NMDA receptor, according to the occurrence of tinnitus. And additional experiments are needed to confirm the implication of cochlear NMDA receptor in other models of tinnitus, because we have a lot of publication on salicylate, and it will be interesting to see the effect in the noise trauma, ischemia, or aminoglycoside and cisplatin toxicity. But NMDA antagonist seems very interesting to treat tinnitus via its effect on excitotoxicity and the effect on synapse activity.
Thank you, Sylvie. Just one last question before we are over, and then the other questions will be answered by email. What cell types are being damaged in tinnitus models? Are there multiple cell types and neurons?
Excuse me, can you repeat, please?
What cell types are being damaged in tinnitus models?
In fact, it depends on the tinnitus models. In salicylate models, there is, as I say, outer access that could be damaged. In noise-induced tinnitus models, it depends on the acoustic trauma induced. In our models, there is no hearing disorders. In fact, there is an increase of the ABR threshold just 1 day after acoustic trauma. Then the ABR threshold returned to baseline. And this result confirms that there is no alteration of air cells in these models. But without alteration, 4 weeks after acoustic trauma, we obtain an upset of tinnitus in our animal.
Okay, thank you very much, Sylvie. Well, unfortunately, we don't have time today to answer all the questions, but Sylvie will answer to you directly by email. So I think, Sylvie, did you want to add anything, or we are done for today?
No, thank you for your attention, and do not hesitate to contact us if you want more information about our models and about the study that we can do with you.
Okay, that's great. Thank you, Sylvie, and thank you everyone for your attention. Please don't hesitate to fill the little survey that pops up in your browser window when you close this window. And don't hesitate also to visit neuroservicesalliance.com to make sure you register for our next webinars. Thank you, and we look forward to seeing you at our next events.